Good morning and welcome to Crossroads. Whether you're joining us here in person or online, welcome. My name is Riley. I'm going to be your host today, and I'm so glad you've joined us this morning. Before we go any further today, I want to introduce you to the Church Center app. If you have not downloaded this app quite yet, take out your phone, look up the Church Center app, and download it right now. This is an app in which you can get everything happening here at the church. You can get our event registration, you can give, you can give prayer requests here. You can even watch the live stream from that app. So if you don't have it quite yet, go ahead, take a moment, take out your phone, download it. We'd love to see you on the Church Center app. Also, if you're looking to give, you can give any dollar amount to 84321. Super quick, super simple, and easy. And guess what? You can give from wherever. And make sure to stay connected with us at aboutccc.com or on Facebook and Instagram. If you have any questions or need anything at all, just ask an usher for help or head to the atrium to our connection point counter and someone will help you there. If you're on the live stream, go ahead and just sound off in the comments. Someone will help you out there. We're so glad you're here with us. Hey, have a great weekend, and I'll see you in there. Church, excited to be with y'all this morning. My name is Justin, and I can't wait to lead y'all. But before we jump into anything else, I know we all come from life and we have things going on that are crazy. You had kids this morning that were causing a fit. You had all kinds of things, traffic lights, that person that you drove by on the road that you're a little bit upset with. We all drive. We all know how that is. But I just wanted to set the space as we walk into this presence of God, as we have this opportunity to lift praise up back up to him in our busy lives. I just ask for you to join me in prayer before we go any further. So let's pray. Dear Father God, we thank you so much for this morning, just for the many blessings in our lives. We don't always pay attention to you in our lives. We don't always notice the things you're doing. But God, right now in this moment, recenter us for another week. Recenter us and give us energy and encouragement and wisdom and guidance as we give praise back to you in this Sunday morning. God, we give this all to you. Amen. If you're able, we invite you to stand.
Great things. Oh. Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You freed every captive and break every chain, oh God. Savior, your name lifted high, oh God, you have done great things, you have done great things, oh God, you do great things.
Hey, while you're all standing right now, turn to someone this morning and just say, hey, welcome. I'm glad to see you here at church this morning.
My shame was white, your arms were wider.
was deeper, my shame was wide, your arms were wider, my guilt was great, your love was greater still. Continue
praising him. He's worthy this morning.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
You have been faithful.
you all join me in prayer. Dear Father God, what a promise. We sing these words, and they're more than just words, but they're our heart song. That idea of the goodness of God in those highs and those lows, those moments we don't see you, we don't hear you, we don't feel you. God, you're still there. You're still fighting for us. You're still lifting us up. You're still encouraging us. So God, right now, as we give this moment to you and as we dig into your word, we pray that you open our hearts and our minds and everything that we are to what you'd have for us in this morning. We give it all to you. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Good morning, Crossroads. How are we this morning? Good. You guys look wonderful and sound wonderful this morning. If you need a blue Bible, you can raise your hand. Our extraordinary ushers will make sure you get one. I'm going to drop you into the Gospel of Luke today as we wrap up this series called One at a Time. We're going to look at Luke chapter 7. So if you get the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, 7th chapter is where we're going to drop into. Depending on the research that you look at, we are told that there are between 6 and 34,000 different emotions that you can experience. 34,000 emotions. And for some of you, you think, well, that's just a normal day for a teenage girl, right? Oh, yeah, well, hey, well, right? I have five granddaughters. None of them are teenagers yet, and yet I see all 34,000 of those emotions played out almost daily. Just ask their mothers. And I doubt that you need a list to tell you how you feel most of the time. On our refrigerator, I don't know where it came from, how long it's been there, but we have this little magnet that has been on my refrigerator forever. And it gives all of these different emotions. And then you put this little cover on it, which says, today I feel, right? Today I feel like somebody put anxious. I don't know if this was put on a refrigerator years ago as sort of a warning as to where people were on any given day. But I think it's interesting that we have this. And if you are not sure of what your emotional state is, ask the people that you live with. If they look afraid or hesitant to answer when you ask the question, what do you think emotional state I'm in today? Then angry or temperamental might be the right answer. The other words that are often asked when we talk about what's your emotional state, people will say tired or frustrated. No, it's more like this, frustrated, right? We feel that. The emotions we feel on the inside are almost always connected to people and circumstances on the outside. It's most often what is going on in our lives, in our world, with the people that we're interacting with that determines our emotional state. As you read through the Gospels, Jesus likewise experienced emotions. This is what's amazing. Joy, anger. He experienced exhaustion, grief, loneliness, and he experienced rejection. But the number one attribute, the number one characteristic, the number one emotion that we see attributed to Jesus more than any other is that of compassion. Compassion. Most of our emotions tend to be self-centered, at least mine do. How we feel is usually determined by what we're experiencing at any given moment. But Jesus' primary emotion was determined not by what he was going through, but by what others were going through. Compassion. When you look at the various accounts of Jesus having compassion, a conjunction always seems to follow those feelings of compassion. It is Jesus had compassion and. Matthew chapter 20 is a perfect example where it says Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, these blind men. Mark chapter 1, verse 41, filled with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. In Mark chapter 6, verse 34, when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So, or we could translate it, and he began teaching them many things. As a matter of fact, if you read this account, and he went on to feed the 5,000, probably more like 20,000. He had compassion. And when Jesus felt compassion, it was always, always followed by action. Now, when we talk about compassion, it means a sympathetic pity, a concern for the sufferings or misfortunes of others. You feel sorry for a family member who's going through a very difficult time, or a friend in need, or someone who has had a loss in their family. And Jesus shows us that compassion is a strong emotion that elicits a response. So the test of compassion, I want to argue, looking at the life of Jesus, looking at his ministry, the test of compassion is in the and. Compassion in our world is the antidote to our indifference, to our apathy. The byword of our age is meh, whatever, an indifference or an apathy in which we find ourselves. So if compassion is the fuel for living a one-at-a-time life, as we've been talking about in this series, that our argument is that as Jesus ministered, as we watch him through the Gospels, that we see these large crowds gather to hear him teach, watch his miracles, listen to what he has to say, look at his life. But he always has a tendency to center in on the one. He spoke to crowds, but he ministered one at a time, one individual at a time. So if that idea of compassion is the fuel for living this kind of life, then how do we grow in our compassion? Because I just want to confess that one of the words that is used to describe me most often is not compassion. It's maybe uncompassion, uncompassionate, no compassion, dead, right? It's sometimes. Eidelman says that to grow in our compassion, it begins with what he calls an eyes-open prayer. Prayer, we know, is an expression of our dependence on Jesus. And we're always dependent on him, whether we realize it or not. It's a constant connection where we're continually available, that we don't have to be in church to pray. We don't have to close our eyes. We don't have to even say these and thous or our Heavenly Father. We can just have a conversation with God. He's always available. Eyes open prayer, though, is seeing others one at a time. Seeing people that I would barely notice otherwise. It's asking that God would give me eyes that are open to see people. Les Parrott and Neil Clark Warren, in their book called Love the Life You Live, tell the story about a man named Ron who was hired by an environmental institute that was dedicated to preserving the endangered species of bighorn sheep that lived in the mountains just southwest of Palm Springs, California. Development of the land around them was disturbing the sheep and interrupting all their breeding activity. And the institute wanted to do something about it. When Ron visited the institute, the director took him outside and pointed to all the massive rocky hills that rolled behind the offices. And he said softly, "There are a lot of them out there today." Ron squinted up at the brown hills, trying to hide his amazement, not at the beauty of the bighorn sheep, but at his inability to even see one of them. Obviously accustomed to this kind of reaction, the director tactfully called his attention to the left. There was a sheep just below a triangular rock and another on the crest of a hill to the left of that. and then another and another. And Ron's eyes began to see dozens of these bighorn sheep. It wasn't that the director's eyes were better than Ron's, but he had learned to see sheep. He knew how their shape broke the subtle patterns of the hills. He could detect a slight difference between their color and that of the rock. It was virtually automatic to him, but it was foreign to Ron until he too learned to see the sheep. Praying with our eyes open helps me to see what Jesus saw, to experience what Jesus felt, to be able to do what Jesus did, to be able to see sheep. Because my tendency most often is I look right past people. But to be able to see and to pray, God, give me eyes that are open. There's something going on. I notice it in their face. I notice it in their language. I notice it in their body movement. Give me eyes to see these things, to see sheep, if you will, one at a time. Luke chapter 7, beginning in verse 11. Soon afterward, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. Nain was a small town that was known for its green pastures. Literally, that's what the name means. It means pleasant or lovely. It's located about 25 miles southeast of Capernaum. And if you read the opening verses of Luke chapter 7, Jesus has just healed miraculously a centurion's servant. He did not go and lay hands on him. He healed him from a distance. It made a powerful impact in that moment. And so a large crowd was following along with him. Verse 12, as he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and a large crowd from the town was with her. At the city gates, two groups pass each other, both of them large groups. Jesus and his disciples are coming into the city with all this gathering, a lot of hubbub, because they've watched this miracle, they've heard his teaching, and then there is a funeral procession leading out of town, which would have been in what we would call an open casket. There was no lid on this box that they would carry the body, and it would be carried on the shoulders of family members and friends. Here in this moment, death meets life. Disorder meets order. Mourning meets ministry. In one group, there is great joy and gladness. The other, sorrow and sadness. And it's especially crowded. We're told at the end of verse 12, a large crowd from the town was with this mother. Maybe family members, but certainly hired mourners, as was the custom of that day. Those who would come to offer their condolences and be with the family through those days of mourning. But also a large crowd was following Jesus. And you have this conglomeration of all these people. But the throngs blur out in that moment and disappear. Because as he most often does, Jesus zooms in on one person. When the Lord saw her, verse 13, his heart went out to her and he said, "Don't cry." What caught his attention was the mother. When he saw her, this dead person, Dr. Luke tells us, was her only son. And what added to her pain was she was also a widow. So for a second time, this woman had been robbed of her provider and protector, because in this male-dominated society, it was the men who would provide for the family. Her husband has died. Now her only son, her provider and protector, is also dead at a young age. Notice the order of events that Luke records for us. First, Jesus saw her, and then second, his heart went out to her. Compassion. There was a connection between what he saw and what he felt. He allowed his heart to engage with what he had seen with his eyes. Jesus always sees the brokenhearted. Remember, that's why he came. And in Luke's gospel in chapter 4, when we see Jesus in essence begin his public ministry, and he goes to the synagogue and he's asked to open the scrolls and read, which was an honor for any rabbi or teacher, he opens the scrolls to the book of Isaiah and he reads these words: "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed," or the King James Version says, "to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." One commentator asked the question, "I wonder in this moment as Jesus is interacting with this woman, if for a moment Jesus was thinking about his own mother, Mary. His mother would soon likewise be a widow weeping over the death of her only son. She would experience these same feelings, these same deep hurts, but he'll not be able to stop that process. The process of his own mother's sword. If you remember in Luke's gospel, chapter 2, after the birth of Jesus, and Mary and Joseph go to the temple to offer up Jesus, to dedicate him, to name him and to have him circumcised, they met an older man there named Simeon. And Simeon, we're told in Luke chapter 2, verse 34, "Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, 'This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed.'" And then I think he looks deep into Mary's eyes and says, "And a sword will pierce your own soul too." Jesus reacted by seeing, feeling, speaking, and acting. And those are great reminders for us as we talk about developing compassion, understanding, seeing people one at a time, seeing them, looking for opportunities. And that means don't be so absorbed in yourself. I have to say that to myself often. It's not about you. It's not about you. Dale Carnegie once said, "You can make more friends in 2 months by becoming interested in other people than you can in 2 years by trying to get people interested in you." What thoughts race through your heads when you walk into a room full of people? I often ask this question of leaders. What thoughts race into your head when you walk into a room full of people? While there are countless responses to that question, most of them fall basically into two camps. Two fundamental responses in our experience come in the form of two quiet questions that tell us a little bit about ourselves. The first question is either, when you walk into a room of people, how am I doing? How am I coming across? Is everybody looking at me? Am I well-dressed? Am I smart-sounding? Or the other is, how are they doing? Wonder what's going on with them. When you walk into a room full of other people, either you're concerned with yourself and the impression that you're about to make, or you're focused on them and what is taking place. And the default for most of us, I'm more concerned about how I'm coming across and the impression that I want to make. And here's the issue. Here's my problem. Our self-focus prevents us from accurately recognizing other people's desires and needs, as well as their motives and emotions. If I don't take the time to look at somebody else and see what they're going through, then I miss the opportunity. Jesus saw this woman. He also felt. Allow your heart to feel. Don't become callous to others' needs and hurts. This is the essence of compassion. His heart went out to her. Then he spoke to her, as we'll see. And the reminder is, speak up. Don't allow the crowd to muzzle you in that moment. If there's something you want to express out of a heart of compassion, do so. They may be waiting for that. They may have needed that this morning. And then he acted. It's the reminder, do good. Do something. Don't only be touched on the inside. Because true compassion must be put into action. Feelings must become touch, or they'll evaporate. Verse 14, "Then he went up and touched the coffin, and those carrying it stood still." Of course they did. What's this guy doing? You don't get near dead people. Doesn't he know that causes you to be unclean? He said, young man, I say to you, get up. Now, I have participated in many funerals over the years. A common occurrence is people talking to the corpse, saying their goodbyes, expressing their love, kissing a loved one goodbye. It's all normal. We talk to them, but we know they can't hear us. But when Jesus speaks to the dead, he speaks as if they can hear him, and they do. They hear him, and they respond. Verse 15, and the dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. This was the same with the others that Jesus raises from the dead. We saw this earlier in this series, the 12-year-old little girl in Mark chapter 5. And Jesus, remember, speaks to her in her mother language, Aramaic, Talitha kum, daughter, arise. And he gives her back to her parents. He raises a friend. And standing in front of his tomb in John chapter 11, Jesus calls him by name, Lazarus, come out. A little girl. A friend, a mother, son. See, the dead are still alive spiritually. They're just detached from their body. And Jesus, he knows how to ruin a perfectly good funeral. It's not the guy you want to invite. Or maybe you do. Here is a precursor of his final mission to ultimately destroy death. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? And I cannot wait to say that someday. Where, O death, is your sting? Na, 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 na. There is none. It's gone. It's been raised. Now, there's a ripple effect in all of this for this act of compassion by Jesus. We're called to love people one at a time, but doing something for one person has this tendency of overflowing to others. The son is healed, but something also happened for the mother as well. Verse 15, the dead man sat up and began to talk. Don't miss the last part. And Jesus gave him back to his mother. Can you imagine, first of all, if you weren't the guys carrying the casket? I mean, what do you think the son first said? Get me out of here, right? I don't think that's what he said. I think what he said when he sat up was, Ima, mother. Ima, mom. Luke says, Jesus gave back to his mother. And what beautiful words Jesus had said to her in verse 13, don't cry, or better, do not despair. Jesus not only gave her back her only son, but Jesus gave her back her hope, her hope. One of the reasons that most of us settle for sympathy instead of acting with compassion is what psychologists call the bystander effect. Instead of seeing ourselves as first responders, we settle for being concerned bystanders. As concerned bystanders, we can feel good about ourselves for feeling concerned while avoiding the risks of actually responding or jumping into the middle of something. Sometimes when we say, well, there's nothing I can do, what we're really saying is, I don't know what to do. And whatever I might do, I don't think it'll make much of a difference. So we don't do anything. Eugene Peterson calls this Afghanistanitis. It's the idea that real opportunities to help people and make a significant difference, well, all those things are in faraway places and in extreme situations. Those are for extraordinary people to make a difference. But look at the response here in verse 16. They were all filled with awe and praised God. Remember, these are large crowds, crowds following Jesus, crowds with this family. A great prophet has appeared among us, they said. God has come to help his people. And this news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. God has come to help his people. They had no idea how accurate they were. God has visited his people, and his name is Jesus. The message translates this: they were quietly worshipful and then noisily grateful, calling out among themselves, God is back, looking to the needs of his people. Now, here's really something important to note here in this account. Nothing is mentioned about this mother's faith. Nothing. There's no mention of a lack of faith. Jesus doesn't call her out for that either. Nothing's mentioned of any lesson that Jesus gave afterwards to these crowds who were following him. It wasn't even prompted by the crowds to prove his deity, that he was the God of death and more especially of life. What I want us to note is it was solely from the well of divine compassion, from the heart of Jesus. Someone broken, hurting, frail, moved the heart of God. As Billy Graham said, the God who has everything wanted me. Wanted me. See, this is the gospel. For God so loved the world, compassion. For God so loved the world that, or and so, he gave his one and only son. Jesus had compassion on us, rebellious, enemies of his, scripture says. Those who would not acknowledge, whose eyes are blind to truth. Jesus had compassion and he gave his life. He died for our sins. He took our place. He was our substitute that we might then have the life of Christ in us. Compassion. And he did something extraordinary. Most of us think we're compassionate because we're sure we're not the opposite of that. We think the opposite is hatred, and we certainly don't feel that about people. But the opposite of compassion isn't hatred. It's, as I mentioned earlier, indifference or apathy. The opposite of compassion, simply putting your hands in your pockets, shrugging your shoulders, simply walking away and going, not my problem, not my problem. I have this wonderful pair of running shoes at my house. A couple years ago, I was given these beautiful running shoes by the Tuesday Night Ladies Bible Study for Pastor Appreciation Month. And when anyone sees them, they are amazed that I have a pair of Brooks. Now, I don't run, okay? I don't run, but when I wear those shoes, people think I do. These are people who don't know me, of course. Those are people, you know, they have no idea. Wearing those shoes can make me feel like I've done something that I haven't. Compassion can be the same way. I believe I am compassionate because I feel compassion. Researchers at the University of British Columbia did studies that show support on social media for people's favorite causes are less likely to donate money or volunteer their time. They're gonna high five it, they're gonna say, love this, what, you know, claps, smiles, emojis, all that, but they don't participate and they don't donate. Why? They feel compassionate, and apparently that feeling's enough. But that's not biblical compassion. It's not Jesus-type compassion. Real compassion doesn't just break your heart. It moves your muscles. Feelings of compassion are God's call to action. The way you know whether you chose compassion isn't by how you feel, but by what you do. We can all experience compassion, but if we want to live the Jesus way, as we've been talking about through this series, one at a time, then we need to have compassion and do something about it. So the prayer that I'm praying these days is, Jesus, help me to have compassion for people and then do something about it. Help me to have eyes, first of all, that are not in a mirror looking only at me, but through a glass window seeing a world all around me that is hurting and in need, in little ways and in big ways, and help me to do something about it. John Eldredge writes, I'm giving my life over to Jesus to live his life every day. And as I move through my day and encounter this or that test, what I now pray when I remember to is this: Jesus in me, help me with this. Not, oh, I got to jump in and rescue. I got to serve them. I got to heal them. I got to feed them. I got to do. Because our tendency is not to pause and ask for God's mercy and help for us, his heart, our compassion. But we're going to do it. And what happens when we do those things without the heart of Jesus, we get burnt out. Because it's after week after week after week of that same person who has a need or a compassion. And sometimes they share my last name. He says, we call upon Christ in us to help us in that moment. For as the once tormented Augustine discovered, Jesus is more interior to us, each of us, than we are to ourselves. He says, your brokenness and your sin are not something you overcome so that you can walk with God. They're the occasions for you to cry out for the life of God in you to rescue you. Not God outside you up in the sky somewhere, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Let this sink in. I love this phrase. Jesus has no intention of letting you become whole apart from his moment-to-moment presence and life within you. Jesus has no intention of letting you become whole, to become more like Jesus, to live this one-at-a-time lifestyle apart from his moment-by-moment presence of his life in you. You cannot become whole. You cannot live this way apart from his presence in you. We've tried. And that's why we become bitter and cynical about needy people. Eldredge says, as we love him, experience him, allow his life to fill ours, the personality of Jesus transforms our personality. Loving Jesus helps us to become what human beings were meant to be. As Athanasius say, he became what we are that we might become what he is. And by the way, we aren't the only ones who need this desperately. The world out there needs this to happen to us. That we see them with wide open eyes. Not as people that we can't stand. As people who are stupid. People who are lost. And they are. But there is a hope for them. And we bear it. We're not the only ones who need this desperately. The world needs this to happen in us so that we can have an impact one at a time. Let's pray. Father, forgive us for so often, forgive me for so often walking around with my eyes closed. Not wanting to see the needs, not wanting to be aware of those needs. Acknowledging sometimes that it's easier just to be apathetic and indifferent or believe that somebody else will take care of the problem than you tapping me on the shoulder. No, you tapping me on my heart and reminding me of all that you have done on my behalf, all that you are in me, and what you desire to do through me. It's not something we can generate in and of ourselves. We don't form a team to show compassion. We gather together to pray and ask for brokenheartedness. We ask for eyes that are open to see the needs around us, and then we pray for you to give us those answers, because sometimes helping can hurt them. Sometimes the best thing we can do is simply cry with them or hold them or comfort them. At other times, it's meeting real, tangible needs. And more than anything, it's always pointing them to Jesus. He alone can meet the needs that are the most important, the heart needs, the spiritual needs, the soul needs, the eternal needs. And the ultimate way in which you showed compassion was that you came to bind up the brokenhearted. He did that at a heart level by dying for us, by going to the cross, by now having your spirit take up residence in us to give us discernment and wisdom, to give us eyes to see and hearts that are broken. So forgive us for not doing what you've called us to. There's somebody this week that we should have spoken to or helped out or come alongside of, somebody we should be praying for. We've simply turned our backs on them because we've been hurt or because we've been hit by that too many times. Help us to understand that compassion comes with an and. And thank you that your compassion came with the cross and an empty tomb. That's our hope. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Church, would you stand with me as we lift one of praise up to God in this wonderful morning?
Would you guys thank the worship team for leading us today, and especially thanks to Justin for coming and leading with us. We appreciate that. Thank you so much. You know, my mind often goes in strange places when I read these kind of passages, and I wonder what this young man's life was like from there on, right? Or like Lazarus, what was his life like? You know, and I think Lazarus' words were maybe not Ema when he was raised from the grave, but it was like, no, 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 don't call me back. Right? I've gone home. But I think their lives were probably transformed. I mean, having died and then risen again. And yet, isn't that our story? We were dead in our trespasses and sin, and now we've been raised to life. We were once dead, but now we live. Our lives are transformed daily by his presence, by his spirit, by his grace and love, by each other, that we remind each other. Hey, I want to welcome you. If this is your first time at Crossroads, welcome. We are so glad that you came this morning. There's a little card in the seat back pocket. Looks like that on the far left. You could fill it out, drop it in one of those offering boxes. Or the best thing is to take that card out to Connection Point, the table out in the middle of the atrium. They'd love to answer any questions you might have, pass along a free gift to you, talk about our next steps of missional communities, getting involved in a small group of people. But also there's another opportunity coming up on Saturday, the July 22nd. So watch the side screens just for a moment about this event. Prizes, lots of family fun, a great opportunity to invite somebody. All of you who have children that were in that video, please talk to them about compassion, because they have none. Saturday, July 22nd from 1 to 4 p.m., and we need some help. Help with the games, help with some food, help just volunteering that day. There's a sign-up sheet out there at the counter. We'd love to have all of you, your family, and your friends to join us on that beautiful day. Receive God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace and a fresh reminder of his compassion and his love. He loves you. He always has, and he always will. Amen. Have a great afternoon. We'll see you next week.